Welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Rekha Pandey from the Department of History in the University of Hyderabad. The module that I'm going to discuss now is titled Women's History in Contemporary India. This is part of the paper 3 of Women's Studies, which focuses on women and history. We have discussed in a large number of modules earlier also, but if we look at the 19th century, it was in the 19th century that for the first time, women's status became an indicator of development of the society all over the world. You know, Britishers were criticizing us that we are not fit to rule ourselves because we were not treating our women properly. There were so many issues in our society like child marriage, illiteracy, sati, the way widows were treated. And these were cited as reasons why, you know, the Britishers were not giving us self-government. Then as a result of this, we had a massive social reform movement which occurred. It was led by a large number of reformers like Raja Ramohan Roy of the Brahmo Samaj, Dayanand Saraswati of the Arya Samaj, Justice Rana Day, who was the pioneer of the Prarthana Samaj, and Pandita Ramabai, who founded the Sharda Sadan to help the upper class widows. And they were all actively involved in this social reform movement. The colonial state also played a massive role in this reform movement. It passed various laws, and sati was outlawed in 1829. Widow remarriage was made legal in 1856. It banned female infanticide in 1875. The Special Marriage Act to allow intercommunity marriages was passed in 1872. In 1891, the age of consent was raised to 12 years. Again, in 1929, you had the Child Marriage Restraint Act, which was passed. And again, in 1937, women got a limited right to property. So, you know, there were so many reforms which were taken up by the Indian social reformers and the colonial state for the upliftment of women. Now, there were various Western women also who contributed to this process. They shouldered the burden of bringing in the benefit of education, social reform in terms of health, hygiene. They also spoke of ideas of political and personal liberation. Now, you had a large number of these missionary women who, you know, you also had a number of theosophists, Indologists, Orientalists. You know, they were all involved in some kind of a reform or the other. Now, when Gandhi came into the scene, Gandhi encouraged women to come out and fight against the British government, and women participated in large numbers in the freedom struggle. One saw the rise of leaders like Sarojini Naidu, Sucheta Kriplani, Ba as very important leaders who led this movement. Now, you know, slowly we find that a kind of gender discourse becomes very important, and it is seen. Anandibai Joshi had graduated from the Women's Medical College in Pennsylvania in 1886. She had joined as a physician in charge of Kolhapur Hospital, and she was very actively involved in women's issue. Kornelia Saurabhji had passed the law in England and India. But you know, she was not allowed to practice because there was so much of sexual discrimination against a woman practicing. And it was only in 1904 that she could become a legal advisor. Then you had women like Ramabai Ranade, who initiated a movement for compulsory education of girls. And Kumudini Ganguly became the first practicing lady doctor in India. And then you had Krupabai Santinandan, who was a prolific writer. She wrote on many aspects related to women's life. And then, you know, you had so many other women who joined in. Sarla Devi Chaudhrani, Rukaiya Sukhawat Hussain, Swarna Kumari Devi, Rasundara Devi, Binodini Dasi. You know, they were all using literature. They were writing. There was prolific writing. So, you know, you had a large number of all these people, right from Indian social reformers, the British colonial state, and a large number of these Indian women who joined the movement for women's emancipation. Now, when India became independent on 15th August and the Republic of India on 26 January 1950, the Constitution gave equality to women. It is there in principle. And unlike the West, you know, though there was some kind of a struggle, women really did not have to struggle for the vote. And women were seen as equal partners with men in development. So independent India had a very clear plan of development that women are also equal partners with men in development. It was believed that, you know, in the period prior to India became free, that, you know, the moment we become masters of our destiny, automatically the whole situation would change. And this was something, you know, where all these rights, the Constitution clearly in Article 14 tells us that there is equality before law. There is prohibition of discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste or sex or birthplace, you know, Article 15. Article 16 talks of equal opportunities in matters of public employment. So, you know, you have all these rights which are given to the women under the Indian Constitution. However, the post-independent period in the 1960s and 70s saw a large spate of movements. And in many of these movements, women also took part. There were campaigns against rising prices. There were movements for land rights. There were a large number of peasant movements. And women from different parts of the country came together. They formed groups both outside and inside political parties. And everywhere in the different movements which were spread across the country, women participated in large numbers. And as a result of their participation, we find that they were able to transform the whole movement from within also. Now, the whole myth that, you know, women were equal, they have so many rights, you know, we were living in this hallucination. This was shattered when the Towards Equality report came up in 1974. Now, this report focused attention on the fact that despite many progressive social legislation and constitutional guarantees, women's status had really not improved much. And it clearly showed that women continue to have an inferior status in many areas like political, economic, and social arenas. So this was something, you know, which came across, and for the first time, you know, this whole myth was shattered that women are equal to men. Now, if we look at the society in the, you know, post-independent India, there are so many areas where we can see a lot of gender gap, whether it is in the area of polity, health, education, economy, and society. So now, you know, when you look at polity, all of us know that, you know, there are millions of women who hold reins of power at the village level. And, you know, we have got the 73rd and 74th amendment where women are elected to the village panchayats. But all of us know what is happening to the women's bill in the parliament. It has been deadlocked for several years. And in many of the political parties, women are invisible. They are hardly there in this actual decision-making bodies. They are, you know, hardly visible in many important, significant policies. In fact, most of the women are always relegated to the women's wing, you know, of the party. And they are made to concentrate on issues which we see as specifically women's issues, you know, such as dowry, rape, violence. And sometimes, you know, there is a general concern with issues like price rise, which is seen to affect more housewives. So therefore, you know, political empowerment, though it is an affirmative action, it is very essential for women to break the hard rock of patriarchy. But then, you know, how many women are visible? Most of the women who are in political power are there because of either their husbands, either their brothers, or their family being part of that political process. You know, very rarely do women who have no connections with any political party come up and be visible in the political front. Therefore, you know, when we talk of poverty and violence, we can fight against them effectively and women can form a critical mass when they are visible in all decision-making bodies. We need to see women present from village panchayats to parliament. This is a very important issue of contemporary India. Now again, when you look at the census, you know, the literacy rate for women is 18.67 in 1971 census. It has risen to 54.28% in 2001 census, whereas men's literacy rate is 76%. Therefore, in many poor households, many girls drop out, and if the parents have to go to work. We do not give any importance to women's education because women have to take care of, you know, these girls have to take care of the household chores. They have to take care of siblings. So, you know, it is women's education that takes a break. Again, if we look at the issue of women and work, women do 2/3 of the world's work. And in exchange, they receive 10% of the income. And according to statistics, they own only 1% of the world's means of production. By and large, women are considered as only secondary workers. If you look at it, there are more women in the unorganized sector than the organized sector. And the unorganized sector is a very unmonetized sector. The whole understanding of work, the value which you give to housework is something which is not there. And a large number of women, because they are not in positions of power, they are below poverty line. And many of the households are headed by women in these poor households. By and large, you know, if you look at women, they are found mostly in professions like teaching. And when I talk of teaching, I don't mean university teaching, but primary school teaching. They are in nursing. They are in clerical jobs. You know, a doctor will always be a male. A nurse would be a woman. A university professor, by and large, would be a male. And the primary school teacher would be a woman. A CEO would be a male. And the secretary would be a woman. So, you know, even in many universities, you find girls topping. But by and large, there are very few women professors in the university system. How many vice chancellors do we have who are women? So, you know, there is such an unequal male-female ratio in contemporary India. If you look at it into surgeons and doctors, it is 7:10. Lawyers, the ratio is 1:20. And teachers, it is 30:0. Nurses, 72:10. Scientists, 10:90. Since most of the women are at the lower level, they get very low salaries. And by and large, you know, India has a labor force of nearly 400 million, and majority of these are women. In fact, 90% of the labor force belongs to unorganized sector. And it has increased now, you know, if you look at the census, it is going up. It is increasing from 94% to 96% in 2001. And in the unorganized sector, because it doesn't have any rules, there are no checks which are there, women continue to be very invisible, and they are so invisible in economic statistics that they are ignored by legislators and planners. So therefore, you know, all the work which women do is not recognized as work. If a woman is a homemaker, she cooks and cleans and teaches her children. This is not recognized as work. You know, if a woman is cooking in her own family, we don't call it work. But if she goes and teaches outside in a school or other children and she gets a salary, this is regarded as work. If you are cooking in your own house, this is regarded as, you know, not work. It is your duty. But if you are cooking outside and you get a salary, this becomes work. Why? Because economists have told us that work is something for which you get paid. And since most of the women are in these kinds of jobs, they are not getting paid. So this is not regarded as work. Another major issue besides work is, if you look at the census data, one of the major issues in contemporary India is the adverse sex ratio. And the national trend shows us a sharp decline from the beginning of this century. You know, for every 1,000 boys, in 1901, we had 972 girls. And by the time you come to 1991, the ratio dropped to 921 for 1,000. And by the time you come to 2010, you know, it is for every 1,000 boys, you have about 914 girls. Now, you know, because of the continued socio-cultural environment, which is very biased against women, we use the new sophisticated medical technologies have also played a major role in strengthening these bias and creating this adverse female ratio. Another major issue of contemporary India is the health issue and the attitude of society towards them. This is something which is referred to as 10:90 gap. Women suffer from 90% of the diseases, but only 10% of the money is spent on their cure. In fact, in 1998, the Nobel laureate in economics, Amartya Sen, stated that economics is not solely concerned with income and wealth, but it has to see how, you know, these resources are being used and to what, means to significant end, including the promotion or enjoyment of long and worthwhile lives. He spoke of 100 million missing women. And he says, you know, this is reflecting the higher mortality for female and the staunch anti-female bias that we have in healthcare and nutrition. He and one of his colleagues examined a lot of hospital records in Bombay, and they concluded that women are taken to the hospital when they are more seriously ill than men. In fact, you know, if you look at the girl child today, this is one of the major issue that the girl child suffers from a cycle of deprivation and disadvantage. This is further compounded by early marriage, premature pregnancies, and its attendant risk. You know, in many regions, you have the dedication of girls as Devdasis, Jogin, Basavis, and it represents a violation of human rights. You know, many of these girls are given as a gift. They become, you know, they are not allowed to marry. They are married to a god, especially the Devdasis and Jogins and Basavis. But they become the common property of village. See, in a village family, if they do not get a son, you know, they pledge that they would, if they have a son, they will give up their first daughter as a Jogin. And many of these girls are exploited in the name of religion. In fact, in one of the surveys, you know, it was shown that many of these Jogin and Basavis and Devdasis, they belong to the scheduled caste. So there is also a caste angle which is there. In fact, many of the girls are treated as being born less than human. As I have said, you know, there is female infanticide. Discrimination begins even before birth. There is a reluctance to seek medical aid for aiding daughters. They are breastfed for a shorter duration than boys. They are easily withdrawn from school to look after the young sibling. So, you know, there is so much of a bias. And this girl child grows with a very low self-esteem in contemporary India. She grows with the notion of a temporary membership in her natal home. She has to be disposed of with assets and dowry. There are so many proverbs which show this bias. You know, a daughter is like a ghee. Both are good to a certain point. If you don't dispose of them early, they start singing. There is another Telugu proverb which says, bringing up a daughter is like watering a plant in another's garden. So, you know, you can see a lot of bias in many of these proverbs. So today, you know, one of the major challenges which women have to face in recent years is the growing influence of religious rights and fundamentalism in India. And then, you know, there is also a major challenge of dealing with gender violence. You know, today you look at it, violence against women is there in family, in society at large. It is all pervasive. It cuts across lines of income, class, religion, and culture. You know, the reason why there is so much violence against women is because women are in unequal power relationship. The whole ideology, the cultural ideology, the doctrine of privacy, sexuality, all this leads to an increased violence against women. So if you look at the life cycle of a girl, you know, there is so much of violence. At the prenatal stage, you have sex selective abortion. They are battered during pregnancy. There is coerced pregnancy. At infancy, there is female infanticides. Girls have different access to food and medical care. The childhood, you know, you have so much child marriages taking place, sexual abuse in the family, child prostitution, trafficking. At the adolescent stage, there is economically coerced sex, rape, sexual harassment. And again, you know, at the reproductive age, women suffer from abuse from male partners, marital rape, dowry abuse, sexual and psychological abuse at workplace. At old age also, there is a lot of abuse of widows, elders abuse, which affects women much more. You know, there are statistics which show that women live a longer life than men. So, you know, many of these women are widows. If you go to places like Vrindavan, you can see how these widows are treated and how, you know, they are just left waiting for their death. Another major issue of contemporary India is the question of trafficking. You know, this has emerged as one of the very important issue on women's agenda of violence against women. In fact, today, violence is generating money next to arms trade and drugs trade. It is prevent at various levels, local, inter-district, interstate, and cross border. So, you know, it is statistics show us that there are at least 8 million women and children in prostitution. And many of them, about 25% of these are children. Child trafficking is on the increase. And at the age at which they are being victimized is also fast declining. So therefore, you know, many of these trafficked victims are trafficked with the promise of better job, better career prospects and marriage. The poverty and deprivation in many regions, the secondary status accorded to women, the prejudice against girl child, you know, the family structure becoming weakening, the changes in public attitude towards sex and morality, the whole class structure, urbanization, migration, the growing consumerism, these are some of the factors responsible for an increase in trafficking. And there have been, you know, in some of the studies which we have conducted, 70% of the victims come from drought-prone area. And added to this, you have traditional forms of prostitution in areas like Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, where you have jogins, matharammas, domarammas, and basavis who are into prostitution. The UN declared in 1993 the elimination of violence against women. And it defined violence as any gender-based violence that results or likely results in physical, sexual, or psychological harm or suffering to women. And it was talking not only of physical violence, but threats of such acts as coercion, arbitrary deprivation of liberty, whether it occurs in the public or private domain. Another issue which received countrywide attention from women's group was in the context of violence against women was the so-called dowry deaths, you know, where young girls were killed for the sake of dowry, which they did not bring money or goods, which they could not bring at the time of marriage. And this was the process of, learning for women. There were so many protests which were organized. Some of these were directed against the state, and women were able to mobilize a lot of support. The state also responded in a very positive way by changing the laws on rape and dowry and making it more stringent. However, just a change in the law means little unless there is a will and a machinery to implement this. You know, the root of the problem is that we have had so many centuries of discrimination against women. We have enough examples in history to tell us how women are treated. And women usually keep silent, you know, out of a fear to either protect the family honor for the sake of children, or many times women think they are at fault. Many women think that gender violence is something which is very normal, it is inevitable, it is a women's lot, and they cannot do anything to escape her lot. You know, violence just does not mean beating a woman, but it has a lot of cost. It has economic cost, political cost, social cost. You know, violence against women is a major obstacle to the elevation of poverty. It results in a lot of cost both to the health and legal system. Violence means that there is a time at loss of work, loss of income for the worker, both for the employer and employee. So violence has an economic cost. Violence also has a social cause because it undermines the important function of family. It threatens the viability of family as an institution. It also affects children, their health, the whole process of nutrition, education, psychological well-being, and enjoyment of right. It also limits women's decision making about reproductive health, and the outcomes are with very negative effects. Violence also has a political cost, because you know today we are all talking of empowerment, but in contemporary India, violence continues. You know, it will not lead to women's empowerment. When women are still being beaten, they lack control over resources over their body, there is really no empowerment. And violence models a way to solve problem. It teaches inequality between men and women and perpetuates gender discrimination. It prevents human security. You know, UNDP for the first time in 1994 presents human security as fundamental goal for development. You know, it said we have to talk about security first within the homes, then we can talk across, you know, national security, terrorism and others. You know, though these are also important, but first we have to start with security from home. The democratic process can only be strengthened when violence is eliminated. Something very interesting about Asian culture is that here, you know, we define masculinity at the expense of women. A woman's honor rests, a man's honor rests in a woman. So, you know, whenever there is a caste war or communal clashes, you know, the worst hit are women. Sometimes due to sexual violence, due to inebriation, there is a lot of violence, and women have no property rights. The way we socialize our girl children, it teaches us inequality. So, you know, both upper caste domination and capitalism has led to more violence against women. Now, you know, nothing sums up this bias more than life expectancy of men when compared to women, which is, you know, the world is the longest in other places. Women have a genetical, biological advantage, which makes them more resistant to infection and malnutrition. While in developed countries, women have an average of 7 more years of life expectancy. In South Asia, it is only 1 year more than men. And this is the lowest in any region of the world. And it really shows us a lot of bias. There is a lot of commodification of women in contemporary India. You know, the advent of globalization has brought in commodification of women. The whole beauty industry that churns out fashion products on a mass scale, it is and deliberates the conversion of beauty into a cult. You know, women are presented as sex objects. You never look at, turn any television, look at cinema. Women are only seen as sex objects, not as builders, achievers, leaders. You know, women becomes redundant beyond looking good. So, you know, we've had a lot of approaches when we look at policy. You know, in the first few five-year plans, the first, second, the third, and the fourth plan, there was a very developmental approach towards women. You know, they gave priority to women's education. Many Mahila Mandals were organized. There was, the Central Social Welfare Board adopted a large number of measures. And slowly from the fifth plan onwards, we shifted, you know, in the fifth, sixth, and seventh plan, we shifted from the welfare approach to a developmental approach. You know, in the fifth plan, there was an integration of welfare with development. The sixth plan spoke of women's development, and this received recognition as a separate chapter. And this was included for the first time in the plan document. There was a thrust on education, health, and employment. In the seventh plan, you had the establishment of the Department of Women and Child Development. And, you know, this was set up. The eighth plan spoke of, the various saw to it that the benefits of development do not bypass women. The National Commission of Women was set up. You had the Women's Development Corporation, which was set up. And India ratified the Beijing Declaration. But, you know, there was again a change in policy from the ninth five-year plan, where we moved from development to empowerment. The Women's Component Plan adapted to ensure that not less than 30% of the funds were earmarked for women-related activities in all ministries. There were schemes on biotechnology where, you know, if women were given, there were separate setup for women under the DPT. And Women's Empowerment Year was celebrated in 2001. The 10th year plan is focusing on affirmative action. You know, there were science and technology policy, which was released in 2003. There were so many scholarship schemes for women scientists. There was a women scientist cell set up in DST. And when we are talking of Millennium Development Goal, we are talking of eradication of extreme poverty and hunger, achieve universal primary education. We are also talking in terms of promoting gender equality to empower women and to reduce mortality. It also talks about improving maternal health, combating HIV and AIDS, malaria, other diseases. There is a discussion on ensuring environmental sustainability and developing global partnership for development. So therefore, when we look at the whole history of women's history in contemporary India, starting from the pre-colonial period, where we already had a tradition of social reform in India, spearheaded by a large number of reformers, by women, by Britishers. And then, Gandhi and Nehru, who were making it a mass movement. In independent India, women come forward. And, there were a lot of legislations which are passed. And we find that some of the issues which really bothered women were issues like, the girl child, socialization, gender violence, looking at trafficking of women, commodification of women. But the government also took a very important step in this direction. And you had the various five-year plans. We started with an welfare approach. We moved into development, and then we were talking of empowerment. There is a lot of affirmative action. So, the whole history of women, history in contemporary India is moving towards more and more empowerment. And yet, at the same time, we also have certain issues which have to be dealt with, which are part of a long history of women in India. Thank you.